On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the cross, the old rugged cross, till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the cross, the old rugged cross, and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary.
Hello and welcome. I'm so glad you decided to tune in today to see this worship service. I want to start off with a profound apology. I had no idea how far and how fast time went since we relocated out here to Tennessee, which is where we're coming from now. Seems like it's been, well, it doesn't seem like it has been, almost 6 months, if not 7 months, since I did one of these, and I greatly apologize. This move was a great deal more than I had ever expected or intended. But we're here now, we're with you. I'm so glad we are. We have been greatly blessed in this move. There had been a number of things that went wrong, but they have all been rectified through the grace of God. And I'm happy to be here with you. I thank you so much for joining us. We will do the same basic worship service that we always did before. We're going to have a couple of hymns, and then we'll have the Lord's Supper. Then we'll have a hymn, and we'll have a lesson. And following that, we will have another hymn, a closing prayer and another hymn. I thank you so much again for being here, and please forgive me for taking so long to do these again. I appreciate your patience. Thank you. And I hope that this morning we will glorify our God and edify you, my Christian brothers and sisters. Thank you again so much for being here. Let's get started with our worship service. Before we begin, would you bow with me? Father, we come before you at this time in praise and thanksgiving. We praise you for being our God, and we thank you for being our God. Father, we would like to ask a blessing upon this worship service and upon all those who are watching. We ask, Father, that you be with us during this service, that you open our hearts and our minds to your word, that you bless this occasion. It is our heartfelt desire that these things that we do be pleasing in your sight. Please be with all those who are sick or afflicted. Be with those who are downtrodden. Be with all of those who need your help. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friend like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. They're all expecting me, and that's one thing I know. My Savior pardoned me, and now I onward go. I know He'll take me through, though I am weak and poor, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, You know I have no friend like You. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Just up in glory land we'll live eternally. The saints on every hand are shouting victory. Their songs of sweetest praise drift back from heaven's shore, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, You know I have no friend like You. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains. And sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stains. The dying thief rejoiced to see that fountain in his day. And there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away. Wash all my sins away. Wash all my sins away. And there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away. Dear dying Lamb, Thy precious blood shall never lose its power, till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more. Be saved to sin no more. Be saved to sin no more. Till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more. Ere since by faith I saw the stream Thy flowing wounds supply, redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die. Redeeming love has been my theme, and shall be till I die.
This morning, before we partake of the Lord's Supper, I thought I would read to you from the 11th chapter of Paul's letter to the Corinthians, his first letter to the Corinthians. I'll begin at verse 23 and following. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which He was betrayed, took bread. And when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Paul was reiterating what Jesus was portrayed doing in three of the four Gospels, of creating this memorial, this Lord's Supper, for us to, as Paul says, remember him. Remember what he did for us. Remember that being the fleshly manifestation of God allowed man to crucify him and kill him so that the ultimate sacrifice could be realized. Because Hebrews tells us that the blood of bulls and goats and the sprinkling on of that blood didn't suffice. It didn't work. It wasn't good enough. But that great sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross was. There'll be a brief pause following the prayer for the bread and for the fruit of the vine. While you partake of these implements, please remember what Jesus did for us. Remember that he sacrificed himself for us so that we might have redemption, reconciliation back to our God, and be forgiven of our sins. Would you bow with me? Father, this morning we come before you humbly as sinners, but boldly as your children, with the understanding that Jesus Christ has paid the price for us. His blood has cleansed us from our sins. Please, Father, bless this bread we're about to partake. Help us to remember that precious body so brutally beaten for us. And bless this cup which we're about to partake, which is a representation of that precious blood that cleansed us from our sins. Father God, be with us and keep us mindful of what this is that we're doing, and allow us to remember Jesus the Christ, just as he asked us to do. It's in his blessed name that we pray. Amen.
Peace, perfect peace, in this dark world of sin. The blood of Jesus whispers peace within. Peace, perfect peace, by thronging duties pressed, to do the will of Jesus, this is rest. Peace, perfect peace, with sorrow surging round, on Jesus' bosom naught but calm is found. Peace, perfect peace, with loved ones far away. in Jesus' keeping we are safe and they. Peace, perfect peace, our future all unknown. Jesus we know, and He is on the throne. It is enough. Earth's struggles soon shall cease, and Jesus call us to heaven's perfect peace.
I have several readings for you this morning. The first one will be in the book of Proverbs. I'll be reading chapter 12, verse 25. Anxiety in the heart of man causes depression, but a good word makes it glad. Then, if you turn back to the psalm, I'll be reading from the 94th psalm. And I'll be beginning at the 14th verse. For the Lord will not cast off His people, nor will He forsake His inheritance. But judgment will return to righteousness, and all the upright in heart will follow it. Who will raise up for me against the evildoers, and who will stand up for me against the workers of iniquity? Unless the Lord has been my help, my soul would not have settled in silence. If I say, my foot slips, your mercy, O Lord, will hold me up. In the multitude of my anxieties within me, your comforts delight my soul. Then if you care to turn over with me to the 139th psalm, I'll read the 23rd verse. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me, and know my anxieties. Then finally in the Psalms, back over to the 46th Psalm, one that will be quite familiar to you. I'll be reading verse 10. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. Then in the New Testament, turn with me to Philippians 4. I'll begin in Philippians 4 at the 6th verse. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, if you would, turn with me to the Gospel of Matthew, the 14th chapter. And I will begin at the 25th verse of that chapter, if you care to follow along. Now in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went to them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it's a ghost. And they cried out for fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, be of good cheer. It is I. Do not be afraid. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water. So he said, come. And when Peter had come down out of the boat, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw that the wind was boisterous, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and caught him, and said to him, O you of little faith, why did you doubt? This move that we made, I need to tell you, was probably one of the most stressful things that I have ever done in my life. Primarily because things happened, things occurred that I was not prepared for. I cannot express to you the doubts and the fears that bombarded me during this move from New Mexico to here into Tennessee. The worst thing that happened was the first moving company that we dealt with came to us shortly before we were supposed to move and told us, well, no, we don't go there. We don't go to that place in Tennessee. So we had to scramble and find someone else to move us. We found somebody else that we thought would be good. And they showed up about when they were supposed to. And it wasn't as we had anticipated that it was going to be. They showed up in a rental truck. We had packed most of what we owned. They came in and packed the rest, loaded it all on a truck, charged me a great deal more than I thought I would be charged, and they left. The next morning, we had a load on a trailer of our own, and we headed for Tennessee. I drove straight through to Tennessee. When we got here, we waited for the end of that week. No moving company, nothing. And I contacted them, and they said, oh, well, you know, don't worry, we still have 20 days to bring your stuff to you. And friends, I remember saying to whomever it was I was talking to on the phone, everything I own in the world is on that truck. And that's when he told me, oh no, we have unloaded it, it's in a warehouse in another town. I honestly believed. And for the next month, believed that I had lost everything that I owned, with the exception of the new place that we moved to. It was more than I have ever faced before. I remember facing the great fire there in Los Alamos, where houses all around me burned to the ground. Mine was damaged, but it didn't burn to the ground. I didn't lose everything. But here I sat in a brand new place, and all I had was my wife and my vehicles. That's all we had. And I prayed hard. But I want you to understand something. I want you to understand that the whole time I knew that it was in God's hands, the whole time that I knew that He had control, that He was going to do what He was going to do, and there was nothing I could do or nothing that I could say that was going to change anything, I was quite afraid. My anxieties had gone through the roof. I prayed nightly to my God. I had a great deal of support from family and from friends, and it just seemed like every turn I took, things fell apart. And I remember thinking to myself at night when I would lay down to go to sleep that God's got this, there's nothing I can do about it. And friends, the only analogy that I can give you that brought comfort to me and allowed me to sleep at night, I imagined myself curling up in the hands of God. I imagined to myself in the darkness of the room sleeping on an air mattress that I was in God's hands, and so I could sleep. I really had nothing to worry about because He had this. He was taking care of it. But still, I worried. I held my wife in my arms on several nights, telling her, I'm afraid we've lost everything we had. I couldn't get anybody to answer me as to where our household goods were, to where all of our possessions were. Nobody would even talk to me. In fact, we got on their ignore list. Every time we called them, we would get put on hold or told to leave an email or a voicemail. And I was convinced that it was all gone, that we would have to start over. My weakness showed through more than I really care to admit or care to tell you, but it did. It showed through. I was convinced that I had lost everything. Finally, better than a month, we got here on the 27th of July, and everything arrived on the 31st of August. Finally. And it was at that time that the story in Matthew of Peter walking on the water till he looked around him and saw everything that was going on in the storm that was taking place, and he lost faith and began to sink. I too had lost faith in God. I thought everything was just gone and I would have to start over. And yet when it did get here, Jesus' words to Peter rang true. Jesus' words to Peter hammered me back to where I should have been. Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt? I read these scriptures to you this morning so that you would understand that I know God's got this. I am completely out of control, as is everyone else on this globe. God's got this. But just like you, I'm a human being. Just like you, I lost faith. Just like Peter, I began to doubt. My anxieties, I did not put on my God. I did not listen to the psalmist. I did not be still and know that God is God. To that end, we have found a good church congregation here in Tennessee. We have placed membership with them, and we are planning on doing as much work as we can there. But by the same token, if you never ever remember anything else, remember that you're not to be anxious. Lay your cares and your thoughts on God. I've got one final reading I want to do, and then we'll have a closing prayer and close this brief worship service. I want you to go with me back to Philippians. Over there in the fourth chapter, where we read about don't be anxious. In everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And then Paul goes on to tell us what we should do, how we should be. Beginning in chapter 4, verse 8. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there's any virtue and if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. The things which you learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you. As I said, I'm a human being. When these kind of troubles and trials hit, it's a very difficult thing to say, God's got this, and let Him have it. I have learned a great lesson in this move. I continue to ask God to help me. I continue to ask God to take care of it. And yet there was that doubt in the back of my mind. But He did. He took care of it. Everything worked out in God's time. To that end, everything will work out for all of God's children in God's time. This was somewhat of a confession lesson because they don't want you to think that I'm any better than you are. In fact, probably in many things, and likely in many things, I'm very weak. But always remember, as you go through your life, never forget, God's got this. And remember those words of Jesus Christ. When you feel at your weakest point, when you feel like all the world is a storm around you and you're beginning to sink, He'll pull you up if you ask Him. But just as He did with Job, He'll ask you, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?" Thank you so much for taking the time to listen to this. It is my desire and my heart's felt wish and hope that in some way this helps you over the many hills and tough trails you'll walk in this life. Thank you for being here. Thank you for taking the time to watch this. May God bless you in all the things that you do. It's customary for us to give an invitation. That invitation is to put Christ Jesus on in baptism through belief and faith in Him. The Gospels tell us that we are to baptize. Gospels tell us that if you believe and are baptized, you're saved. That if you don't believe, you're not. Jesus tells us that to fulfill all righteousness, baptism is necessary. If there is a need that you have, if you just need to talk, I have left my phone number on the beginning of this video, and I've left my email on the beginning of this video. Contact me. I would be tickled to hear from you and to talk to you. I can find nothing that would stop us from allowing you to put Christ Jesus on through faith and baptism, if that's a need. Again, thank you for being here. Would you bow with me for a final prayer? Father God, we thank you so very much for all that you've done for us. We thank you for your majestic blessings. We thank you for being our God. We ask, Father, that you guide us through this week, that you cover us with your mighty hand, that you open our eyes and our hearts to know that it is you that walks before us. Allow us, Father, into the depths of our soul to be still and know that you are God. Forgive us, Father, of our sins, and remember us, your children, that we are but dust. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Again, thank you. Thank you so much for being here. We'll have one final hymn, and then that will be it for this worship service.
On torrid and stormy banks I stand and cast a wishful eye to Canaan's fair and happy land, where my possessions lie. We will rest in the fair and happy land by and by, just across on the evergreen shore. Sing the song of Moses and the Lamb by and by, and dwell with Jesus evermore. O'er all those wide extended plains shines one eternal day. There God the sun forever reigns and scatters night away. We will rest in the fair and happy land by and by, just across on the evergreen shore. Sing the song of Moses and the Lamb by and by, and dwell with Jesus evermore. When shall I reach that happy place and be forever blessed? When shall I see my Father's face and in his bosom rest? We will rest in the fair and happy land by and by, just across on the evergreen shore. Sing the song of Moses and the Lamb by and by, and dwell with Jesus evermore. Filled with delight, my raptured soul would here no longer stay. Though Jordan's waves around me roll, fearless I'd launch away. We will rest in the fair and happy land by and by, just across on the evergreen shore. Sing the song of Moses and the Lamb by and by, and dwell with Jesus evermore.